Very great. Here we go. What's the best thing that you can do? Follow the advice of the Holy Spirit. That's the best thing you can do. Okay? Holy Spirit gives us advice. No question about it. The Holy Spirit gave me tremendous advice today. Now, it may not always be advice that you want to hear. In fact, very rarely it is. But the key to your life is to follow the advice that's coming from the grace of God. There is no other key to your life. If you want to escape from misery, it's the only way. It's the only way. Today, the Holy Spirit gave me extremely compelling, unavoidable advice, and I'll just pass it on to show that it is happening in our lives. Don't think for a minute the Holy Spirit isn't giving you advice. It's giving all of us advice. It's just that we have trouble following it, listening to it, because we keep asking the ego, well, hey, ego, what do you think about that? And the ego says, well, yeah, it's pretty good. I kind of like that advice, but you know, I think this is better. I said, no, don't ever listen to the ego. Its advice is worse, much worse. It just, we're so used to the lies that it tells me, think, yeah, okay, I can. Don't. Holy Spirit, what did it convey to me today, unmistakably convey? We're at orange light period. Orange light, meaning on a traffic light. You know, it goes green. Okay, green is, okay, everything's fine. Orange is like, uh-oh, I've got to make a decision. I have to, do I go through the intersection or do I stop? In other words, orange light means it's decision time. And we are in orange light time right now. We have to make crucial decisions right now. So, what did the Holy Spirit tell me I have to do? It was amazing how this happened. It always is amazing. The Holy Spirit, the way it orchestrates your life, is, you just say, is it possible to orchestrate it this way? Yes, it is possible. The Holy Spirit told me I have to work out more and go faster and push it. And I said, well, work out in what way? And then it made it very clear to me. It said, well, mentally, you're fine. No problem. You're gonna pass mentally. You've got it. But physically, it's still tough for you. It's still tough. And I said, well, you're right. You know, wow. It's hard to hear that, because I am just crushing it with my workouts, but the Holy Spirit said, you got to push it more. And it's like, wow. And I said, you know, you're right. As tough as that sounds, the Holy Spirit was right. It's right. That's my weak spot. Mentally is not my weak spot. So the Holy Spirit will point out your weak spot to you. And say, this is where, you know, what a great friend to point out what your weak spot is so you can work on it. So I took action. I took action on this today. I ordered something, a couple things ordered to help me with my balance and core, which I feel is my weak spot, is the my core balance has to be better, has to be better. And I things worked out. I got some help. Somebody helped me financially with it. And I helped them out by ordering something to help with our core stability and balance. Physically, we want to feel that we have this tremendous balance, that someone pushes us this way or pushes this way or something, like you're riding a big wave. No matter how the wave is jostling you about, you know, you're like, I can just keep my balance like this, like that, you know, like riding a wave. This is how it is when you're riding a wave, you know, you're just thrown every which way. You never know how you're going to be thrown, maybe two different ways. And somehow, like a cat, you always land. This is core balance. And this is super important. The Holy Spirit says, you got to go after this faster. Now, I'd like to sit back and get, you know, play it smart, say, hey, Holy Spirit, you know, I should work mentally, you know, I'm always, no, you're fine. So we always have excuses, don't we? But the time now is so serious, we cannot make excuses right now. So there's always some weak area in your life that the Holy Spirit knows about and will tell you about. So what is it? You have to find out what it is and then get after it right now. Now, maybe yours will be different than mine, okay? Maybe there's a reason. Everyone has some uniqueness to them, okay? So this is just an example. You must ask the Holy Spirit, okay, what do I need to focus on? And then listen, and the Holy Spirit will bring it to your attention for sure. Remember, the Holy Spirit, the entire thing is a play of attention. And the Holy Spirit will play your attention in such a way that, aha, it's revealed to you. And you say, oh my gosh. So, it's amazing how things happen. I found something, a discarded part of a plant that's really heavy. I got something that's like, and I said, you know, I could use this fitness-wise. And it's turned out to be like the ideal thing. It's amazing to do all sorts of core work where you throw yourself off balance and you got to, you know, throw yourself this way and throw yourself this way and throw yourself this way. And you have the strength to be twisted this way and that way, and still you feel like you're centered. Now, we might think, well, all we need is mental centering. This is why I tell the Holy Spirit, oh, let me center myself mentally. That's fine. Well, the Holy Spirit knows better than that. Now, I've been talking to a lot of people, and they all agree. They say, you know what? It's good to also have some confidence in physically to be fit. It gives you a certain little bit of confidence there because we're still deluded. We cannot just completely ignore the body. We'd like to be, right? We'd like to be able to be the guru. But guess what? We're not yet the guru, okay? In terms of our, we're still imagining limitations to what we are. So, pragmatically, we'd better have a certain flexibility, physical flexibility and balance and strength in 360-degree kind of conditioning, the kind of cross-training conditioning. This is what the Holy Spirit has been working with, trying to get me to get that part of my life in more in balance. Because the world is going to throw everything at us now. Okay? Everything. Now, another thing the Holy Spirit has pointed out, not only the Holy Spirit, but all the spiritual Dharma kings I'm in touch with and friends with. Dzogchenpa is the formless self, we call it, but Padmasambhava, okay, for instance, Longchenpa, Jangyan Kyentse Choki Lodro, Jesus Christ, St. Paul, St. Jude, Sri Sri Anandamayama, Ramana Maharshi, okay. So these are just, you know, these are my friends. I'm in touch with them. I'm able to get help from them. And they all agree that we're entering a time of extreme turmoil, and they characterize it by a fire, which is they mean mental agitation, the fire of mental agitation. People are going to be on fire in terms of being agitated in their psyche. And they made it very clear to me that my job is to play the role of fireman and help put out the fire, help cool it down. And this is what their whole plan and purpose is. They have a plan and they have a purpose. And I asked Longchenpa for help today, and he gave it to me immediately. And he showed me very clearly what we have to do. And he said, what he showed was, you have to get out of the mainstream, detach from the mainstream, go into a side stream where it's cool, where the stream is not running so fast and getting so agitated. Imagine the mainstream as this cataract of extreme water, you know, pounding down a mountainside and boulders, and the water's just being thrown all over the place, and it's just raging like that. And a stream, compare that to a nice little stream that's kind of just flowing nice, kind of quietly and babbling as it goes along nice and small. Say, oh, that's so much more peaceful, isn't it? This is the difference. We have to get out of the mainstream. The mainstream is going to be one of a severe agitation. Go, no question about it. This has been hammered into me for so long, and the drumbeats from the Dharma kings are so strong right now. I take it with utmost seriousness. So they have ways and means to help the world out, to help move us away from that mainstream of agitation. Most in the world are just really going to become desperate. And they're going to be desperate for something that will calm them, cool them down. And so we have plans to help out with that. And I got to, I have some role to play, some little role to play. And we all have some little role we can play, but we better be ready for that role, okay? It's a serious, serious, serious business here. So we could just wow this for a moment here. How we got 10 minutes, 10 minutes in, and we're already hitting it hard. It's been made crystal clear to me that trouble is going to come, period. Okay, so forget about politics. I ask everyone to be non-aligned with politics as I am. I speak to liberals and I say, look, stop being so liberal. I speak to the conservatives, I say, stop being so conservative. Get out of that polarization, political polarization. I tell you this for sure. If you lie down with either of these sides, you're lying with poisonous snakes, okay? Absolutely, you are. Do not get into bed with either of these sides, the liberals or conservatives. Stay independent, stay non-aligned, stay non-politicized. It's crucial because that's the mainstream. That's the trap that's being set. There's a trap being set in the world. It's a very insidious trap that's being set. These politicians are just minor players on the stage, actually. There's way more behind it than this. Don't get pulled in to any politics, actually. And if I ever say something politically or something, I'm trying to help those who are polarized, saying, look, get away from your attachment to your party, to this, and get away from it. Whatever it is, get away from it. That will not serve you well going forward at all. Both are poisonous snakes, and that's putting it very mildly. What we need to get to is right spiritual practice. The three jewels of the Dharma kings, the saviors, the teachers, the avatars, the gurus, the saints, and write their teachings and the practice from those teachings and the community of those support one another. This is what serves us well. The other only is a trap and serves us horribly. There is no political solution to the situation we're in whatsoever. It's only a spiritual solution. And the whole thing about trying to drag everyone into politics is a trap. It's a trap. They want to get us so agitated and that we cannot see clearly at all what we need to see. We lose sight of the fact that we're already perfect. We lose sight of it. It becomes very difficult. The momentum is in the wrong direction. Your habits become undermined. Your good habits become undermined, severely undermined. And you find you've just absolutely abandoned everything that was right about your life, and now you find yourself just to be this agitated ideologue. Okay, that's what we have to avoid at all costs. Now, there's no question that most are quite vulnerable to this right now. I'm finding very few who are able to step out of the mainstream. However, almost everyone I talk with understands that we're headed for trouble, and they don't like it. And they're saying, yeah, I really would rather stay out of this. They're all that way. Everyone's that way that I talk with. But they don't know how. They don't know how. But they all know, we're going to the guillotine here. I mean, what can we do? Well, there are things set up to help. I trust the Dharma kings. I trust them that they know what we can do. Now, what it does is we want to steer people in away from the worst of it. Okay? You cannot right now just, snap your fingers and everybody just wakes up. It doesn't work that way. What we can do is give them something that isn't nearly as bad. And for many, you know, that some sort of harbor, some sort of refuge, some place that's a little bit out of the storm, right? That they can, you know, they can, some place to take refuge in some way. It's taking refuge is where it's all about in the future now. Where do you take refuge from this storm that's coming? There's a big, big psycho, spiritual, somatic storm that is coming, and it'll be ferocious. Where do you take refuge? So, this is where it's at. I mean, we're right here where it's at. And the Holy Spirit says, I'll work out, boy. Oh, you, wow, okay. So I hit it hard today, upper body. Hit the lower body super hard yesterday. Hit the body super, upper body super hard today. My back's not feeling so great. Yeah, but now is the time to, you know, pedal to the floor. Pedal to the floor. It's orange light time. Just imagine you're going to an intersection. You see the orange light. And you say, okay, what do? Do I go forward or do I brake? Right? Well, what happens if you want to go forward? What do? You accelerate, right? You accelerate. You see the orange light, you have to decide, am I going to stop? Am I going to stall out? Or am I going to bust through that intersection, go through? Say, okay, let's go through. Then you accelerate through. Say, I made it. And it's a tough one, because you know sometimes when that orange light, it happens just at the exact moment where you're in between. You're in between. You just say, oh my gosh. And there's that moment of hesitation that's terrible. You're not sure what I should break or go through forward. In Silicon Valley, everybody goes forward. Nobody breaks. If you break, someone's going to rear end you. You might think, I'm safe because of, you know, no, there's a person behind you. They say, oh, okay, you should go, you should go, you should go forward. So anyway, you know the feeling. And so we have to decide what we're going to do. And I say, you know, go for it. Go for it. Go through the intersection. So I'm hitting it hard. I'm hitting it hard today. Wherever I go, I just start doing exercises, actually. The gas station, I've got this wonderful exercise for the gas station now. It's just tremendous, upper body. I put gas in, immediately I start hitting it and boy, do I get a burn. I said, wow. And then wherever I go, I'm doing some exercise. I'm running up a hill, I'm doing this. Keep, you know, pushing this fitness. And we're gonna need it, Though some of us, that may not be exactly what you're doing. Let me boost up the light on this if I can. There you go. All right, I'm gonna do that. But whatever you're doing, you need to be now just, you know, full on. You could characterize the world as saying it's trapping us into sickness. How would you like to feel to be trapped in it? The demand is, it's demanded that you be sick and ill. This is a way of looking at it. You're going to be everyone's going to be extremely unhappy in such a situation. So we have to take the edge off of that. And people say, well, yeah, I don't really want to be trapped in that yet. So I think I'm going to sidestep it for right now. Maybe later I might want to be trapped in feeling I have to be sick and that's my destiny. But right now I'm not quite ready for that. This is what is crucial. And so I'm just giving the best advice I can, and you know it's rough because I don't get any feedback at all from anyone whether anybody is following this advice or not. Very rare, just a little bit. You know, there's a few, but super rare. Do I get any feedback whatsoever? So I just have to keep, you know, I'm following my own advice for sure, So if you want to know, is anyone following my own advice? Absolutely, I am. Absolutely. I'm just crushing it. What did I have for dinner tonight? I had two apples, half a banana, and 10 strawberries with tart red cherry juice, and blended it up in a smoothie and drank that down. That was my dinner. I'm eating more and more and more fruit. I just fruit smoothies. With and the protein is Greek yogurt with whey protein powder. And then I'm also eating, sometimes broccoli and kale for vegetables. I'm going heavily to fruit right now. The Holy Spirit's indicated this. This is very, very helpful. And of course, boycotting everything else, basically boycotting the world. And then working out like crazy. And doing more and more difficult workouts. You got to run down a mountain? Oh, God. Then the Holy Spirit says, yeah, run down sideways. What? Yeah. Okay, I get you. Okay. Meaning stability, right? I mean, going sideways is very important right now. It's extremely, if you want to know a great workout, instead of jogging down the street, go sideways down the street. Okay, you could do that. Just kind of scuttle like a crab sideways. It's very important to back up, go sideways. You should have 300, your gearing should be in 360 degree gearing, okay? Including vertical. I don't know how, and crouching down. But as far as moving, if you're 360 degrees, you should be able to move sideways just as easily as you can move forward. And you should be able to move backwards just as easily as you can move sideways. This is what the Holy Spirit's telling me. So, in other words, don't be so robotic. Don't think that I'm just jogging. Okay, that's it. No. That's not it. We're past that. We've been there, done that. That was the 80s. Okay, we've been there and done that. Those are the Clinton years, you might say. Okay, which is fine for then. But now we're way past that. And we need to be going sideways. It's funny, I started doing this. I saw a yoga girl doing that yesterday, tattooed yoga girl. Boy, she was tattooed up and everything. But she was going upstairs sideways, and that's something that I do. I said, yeah. So, of course, even yoga girls get the blues. You got to remember that. But some of them, they know that, okay? So don't be stupid. Start working out sideways. I'm getting help. People are telling me stuff they don't even know what I'm working on. It just comes out of their mouths. They say, yeah, I need this kind of exercise is like unbelievably, wow, it's really tough. And then I realize, oh yeah, I'm supposed to be doing that, and I start doing it. So you want this strength that is there no matter how you're pushed or twist and turn. You just feel supple. And on balance, you feel supple, on balance. That is super, super important for many of us. Now, of course, every situation is different. So don't freak out if you say, well, I can't do that, or I can't do this or that. Don't freak out at all. But there's something that you can do. The Holy Spirit wants you to do it. It wants you to be great at it. Really, really, really great at it. Because you need to be like a fireman, also fire person, to help cool it down. I have had a YouTube channel, The Cool Down Place, and I try to make videos that cool everybody down. I've been working on this for a long time. And just, if people just don't seem to get it so much, it's faint. It's fuzzy and it's faint. But they're desperate. I can tell everyone is desperate. They realize, yeah, everyone I talked to says, yeah, I mean, it's a disaster coming. Does anyone have any clue what to do about it? No, they don't. They don't have any clue what to do about it. It's like, wow, that's not good, is it? What are you going to do about it? They kind of laugh. Basically, I think most of us feel just kind of robotically go along like a zombie and hope we get lucky. Hope we get lucky. Well, it's the same, we make our own luck, right? We make our own luck. And when things go well for you, people say, oh, you're lucky. And I say, yeah, well, I made my own luck. If you want to look at it that way, I made my own luck thanks to the advice of the Holy Spirit. This is what you want to be able to say. Holy Spirit said, yeah, play it this way. I played it that way. Hey, guess what? Things worked out well. I'm lucky? Well, luck is the residue of design. The more I work at it, the luckier I get. Well, you're just lucky that you were able to avoid that. Yeah, well, luck is the residue of design, if you want to look. Yeah, so don't fall for this notion that somehow you're just going to luck out. This is what the ego tells you. The ego says, this whole existence is just this, it's just luck. You know, it's just fate. You know, some get lucky, some don't, and eventually you'll get lucky, but, you know, you never know when. It's the ego. And the Holy Spirit says luck has nothing to do with it. Absolutely nothing to do with it. Now, we're kind of thinking, maybe it's a little both. But you know what? Why don't we err on the side of caution and listen to the Holy Spirit? And let's try and work as much as we can. Okay, and then we'll see how things go out that way, how it goes that way. Let's do our very best and take our chances with that instead of just being lazy and taking our chances with lazy luck. Lazy luck, lady luck, what's the difference? Basically, the lady is there to help you be lazy. So, and the ego says, yeah, you know, the more lazier you are, the luckier you get. So here's this lady luck who will help you be lazy, bad habits. The siren singing this song that pulls you into bad habits. The ego says, great, great, great. Now you're going to be luckier because you're not trying, you're not trusting in the Holy Spirit, and you're not trusting that you're in control of your destiny. So you should get even luckier now. What it means is you got no hope other than luck. And the ego tells you, if you just have no hope other than luck, somehow luck will shine upon you. No, it doesn't. You know what? It doesn't shine upon you at all. It doesn't work that way. And then you feel like you've been abandoned. Like, well, luck abandoned me. How come? I was never there in the first place. The ego just led you into a trap. Okay, the ego leads us into a trap. And that's what's happening in the world. Believing in luck, believing in humanistic, efforts, following the advice of the ego. This is all a black hole that the world's going into. It's going to a spiritual black hole of trusting in the ego. Why we've glamorized it so much. And we've just, it's an atrocity. This world is an atrocity that's taking place. We've been misled to an extreme extent, and we're all aware of that, but we don't know what to do about it. It's kind of like the cattle. They're in the cattle call. They say, hey, I don't think this is good for us. Well, what do we do? What do we do? We're in the feedlot. This doesn't seem like the pasture. I don't know. This is kind of, I'm nervous about this. Right. Well, the first thing we do is we ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to do? How can I help out? That's all you need to ask us. How can I help out, Holy Spirit? I want to help out. How can I help out? How can I be part of the solution instead of part of the problem? How can I turn everyone away from luck, right? Belief in luck. It's a devastating plague that's coming from the world. It's coming from every direction, actually. Every direction. Everyone I talked with is contaminated. They're just contaminated. Very few are pretty much free of that. And somehow we've forgotten about the Holy Spirit. Isn't that amazing? Can you believe this? If someone who spans generations, which is what I am, I can tell you that it wasn't even remotely like it is now back in the past. People actually trusted and believed in the Holy Spirit and spoke about it. Nowadays, people look at that and think that you're crazy. That's how far we've fallen. And I get reports from people all over about their kids completely addicted to these video games and graphics from starting very early age now, 3 and 4 years old. And that's their parent. Those are the parents. I mean, they hardly even know who their parents are most of the time. They just let me give me my food and my and then I'm fixated on these graphics. This is a severe illness. Who do you think is controlling the graphics that they're watching? Pharmaceutical companies, big corporations, people who want you to be sick. They want you to be professional sickers, professional sickers. A sickons, instead of person, sicken. They want you to be sickens. Professional sickens, like cows. Just the milk, what's the milk sickness? They don't want you to realize the true power of your mind, which is perfectly capable of instantly settling all illness once and for all, like it never existed. They want to lead you as far away from that as possible and bury that truth as deeply as possible with as many taboos and fears and lies piled upon it that you'll never, ever, ever, ever even go in that direction ever. This is what they want. And this is how, this is the culture, the world culture is designed this way right now. It's absolutely designed this way. And people are sliding down, going down the drain, and they're kind of saying, whoa, this is kind of weird. What's going on? And then when you say something, it just doesn't seem to register. Holy Spirit, what? But there are ways. So don't give up. Don't give up. There are ways that you could say at the last minute, ah, wait a minute, not quite ready to go down the drain yet. Oh, there's this nice little platform, or a little life, a raft. Oh, not quite ready to drown yet. Oh, there, my God, there's a raft there. Yeah. Oh, let me pull myself up on this raft. Oh, okay, I'm not quite drowned yet. Then you say, huh, that's interesting. Well, how could that raft just come along at that time, right then, right when I did wanted it? Is there it is? Oh my gosh, very interesting. But most in the world are paying lip service now to the Antichrist. Say, oh yeah, sure, yeah, we're all with you, we're all with you. Don't worry, we're all with you. But in the back of their mind, they're saying, ah, if I get, they're not quite ready to drown yet, right? They're not quite ready to drown. So hold that in mind, that we're not quite ready to drown. In spite of everybody kissing up to those who would drown us, lead us into drowning. So we're not quite ready for that. Thank God, right? But some are. They've convinced themselves that but the majority are not ready to drown. Just keep this in mind. If you decide you're not quite ready to drown yet, you're in the majority. You're in the majority by far, by far. The diehards who think that if they're just loyal to the ego that somehow they'll get lucky, which is what they're believing in. They're the activists, they're the ones that are the leaders, the activists, all the ones. But the majority of people, their attitude is not quite yet like that. Yeah, no. So you're not in some rare minority if you decide the last minute, nah, I'm not gonna quite go that way. You're not. You're actually in the strong majority. So you're people are acting quite ambivalent at this point, but at some point they're gonna pull back from it and say, yeah, I'm gonna take another look at God first before I go all the way in on the ego here and cast my fate upon the winds of chance and hope and fear and luck. I'm gonna take a I just want to take one more look at God. Of course, the ego's gonna be really upset about that. It thinks it has us, And it's going to be really, really angry. I remember the dream I had quite some time ago is I made that decision, said, not quite ready to go with that direction, ego. I'm gonna take another look at God. Boy, was the ego mad. Just like cursing me. Yeah, just like, crazy. You know, what are you doing? What? Like, I thought I had you. The ego always thinks it has us, but it never quite has us. But the ego tells some activists that if they pull everybody else down, that's going to improve their luck. So they try to pull everyone down, hoping that, okay, that'll make me luckier. It's going to improve my luck. Yeah, lady luck, you know, help me, lady luck. Lady luck is a loser. Born loser. So, don't even fall for those who use gurus to try to camouflage and pull you into the mainstream, pull you down in some way. Some people even do that. That's possible, you know, that I mean, people use Jesus for that. People will use any of the Dharma kings. It's possible to use them in a way to camouflage trusting in luck. Okay, but we're adamantly clear here. That's the wrong path to take. And we won't take it. And be very clear. Trust yourself. Trust in God. Trust in the truth. And trust in the non-dual realization that is there for us, that one insight settles it all. Trust in that. There's one insight that settles all your misery. And you're just one little insight away from that. So it's no time now to give up. It never is. This is what the ego doesn't know. The ego feels very threatened. So it wants to use this earth as a hiding place from God. This is what's happening. And there are cosmic entities from other places in the cosmos that want to use this planet for a hiding place from God. And many are going along with that, and they say, yeah, we're terrified of God. God seems to be an abyss to us, so we've got to, you know, got to hide from God so God can't find us. This is their attitude. Of course, God is everywhere. Always has been, always will be. God is everywhere. How can you hide from God? God is everywhere. There's no place where God is not. And we're just deluding ourselves. So there's no abyss. The abyss is a weird logical, you know, mistake to think that if we can't hide from God, then that this equals an abyss. It's an abyss of not being able to hide from God. But this is kind of like a weird definition of an abyss, right? It's like saying there's no abyss is the abyss. Well, only a lunatic would conclude this, right? That no abyss is the abyss. To say that the fact that God is everywhere, that means that there's this terrible abyss. How could there be a terrible abyss? Well, I can't hide from God. Okay, so you can't hide from God, but how does that equal an abyss? What it means is, in order to hide from God, I'm going to have to jump into an abyss. That's what it really means. They're saying, oh my gosh, so God's everywhere. Okay, so the only way I can escape from God is to jump into some total abyss. Of course, if God's everywhere, there isn't any total abyss. So we cannot jump into any such abyss, but because we desire to be separate from God, the fact that God is everywhere, we conclude then that we must jump into some terrible, complete, forever abyss. And then we think, well, that's not fair, it's horrible. So let's just imagine that God's not here in this world, and we can hide here in this world and you know, call it good. But then we're still like nervous, right? Saying, you know, wow. Remember in your workouts to keep doing lateral stuff, going backwards, lateral, side, to not simply be a robot pumping iron or someone just jogging or just running straight ahead or something. No. That's fine as just part of what you're doing. Because whatever happens in the world, there's a physical reaction to it. It's really mental, but because we believe we're a body, it feels physical. So if you really feel balanced in all 360 degree balance, you're going to be able to handle that a lot better. Now the women get this because they're focused on, of course, having children and raising their children. So they want to survive whatever happens. Okay. So you see the yoga girls are just crushing it, really. And I do get inspiration from them. I see them, what they do, and I say, wow. I mean, they're like elite in terms of physical preparation. Now, mental preparation, they're terrible. They don't have any mental preparation. They're awful at that. I've got the mental, but I need to have better physical. I'm getting there. And so the yoga girls are actually helping me out. So, I'll help them out some at some point, too. Because I see what they're doing, and I realize, wow. So, they're good at it. They're good at it. They understand. Who was going laterally upstairs? A yoga girl. It's like, yeah. That's very, they understand that, see, they want to survive so they can keep producing bodies. This is the mandate the ego has for women, is to keep producing bodies. So the ego puts great emphasis on women surviving at all costs. So the women are aware that there's trouble coming. They're more aware than men. And they're working out so they can physically survive. They take things very physically, which is emotionally also, very physically. They feel it in a physical way, which produces emotions. But they want to be very flexible, 360 degree, great core strength. So whatever happens, they can, still survive and go with it. Whatever happens. This. So you see that. That's very good training physically. But of course, mentally, you also have to have 360 degree-ness. And they don't have that. That's the trouble they have. They're not really focused on that. They say, well, that's not my problem. That's men's problem. My problem is having children. Yeah, that's a big problem, isn't it? But like, nobody, just like nobody can work out for you, nobody can work out for you mentally. You have to do it also. So just like I have to work out physically now, the yoga girls have to work out mentally also. And that's their weakness. And the ego says, forget it. It's not important. Just have the kids, keep the bodies coming, help get a better hiding place here and you'll be fine. But again, they know trouble's coming. Yeah, like I told you, I've always been quite impressed by how hard the yoga girls are hitting the workout. I mean, they're serious about it. Really serious. The guys, most guys, not as serious, actually. Not as serious. The guys kind of show off a little bit. It's okay. No, the yoga girls are out there, and they are just deadly serious about it. And so we should take that as a severe warning. Because this means that they expect tremendous turmoil, and they're preparing their bodies for that to see if they can get through it emotionally. Well, it might be real tough to get through it emotionally, actually. The trick for the yoga girls is to start, right mental practice. Problem is the ego keeps telling them, no, you got to work on the physical. That's what you need to do. And so they kind of you know, halfway it too much. To halfway it way too much. And they say, well, I don't need to do that much. I got to keep the physical real strong. And I only do a little of that. That doesn't work. So just like me, I think, well, my mental's strong. I only have to do a little of the physical. And the Holy Spirit says, no, you got to get in good shape here. So, wow, okay. But the mental is way more difficult. That's a lifetime dedication. The physical, you can get in shape in a year or so, actually, if you really work at it. Whereas mentally, no, you can't get in shape in just a year. It's a lifetime commitment. But fitness can be too. A lot of people are dedicated to fitness their whole lives. The yoga girls can be that way, most certainly. They start out young with a lot of sports now, and then they hit it real hard for marriageable age, and then they hit it even harder preparing for to have children. Then after they have children, they hit it real hard to get back in shape, and then they hit it hard to have like a retirement and travel and all. So they spend a whole lifetime staying in really great shape, actually. So why can't we have a lifetime of staying in great mental shape? Because there are exercises that we do for that. Full stop and the wow is the primary exercise. It's a 360-degree cross-training, spiritual cross-training program that we have here. Very much spiritual cross-training. Cross-training is the best exercise. As I said, we followed Laird Hamilton's advice in terms of keep mixing it up what you're doing. I invented this exercise, a piece of equipment today. In fact, a couple of them. The Holy Spirit says, do this. It's amazing. It's amazing what's happened. I can tell you what I did. And you can do the very same thing. It's very easy. Go down to your local hardware store and buy a 10-foot piece of Schedule 40 1-inch PVC pipe. Okay, 1-inch PVC pipe, Schedule 40. It's stronger. You need a strong pipe. Don't get the thin irrigation pipe. Get the strong Schedule 40 PVC irrigation pipe, 10 foot long. And get two caps. Get two caps for it. So you're going to cap both ends. Cap one end, okay, tape it up. Get some stucco tape or Gorilla tape or duct tape, whatever, strong tape. Tape the end on. It works. It's easy to do that. And then get some sand. Buy a bag of sand, or if you have some sand, that'll work. But buy a bag of sand and get a scoop or something. And you could use a funnel. I just use my hands and fill the pipe up with sand. Fill the pipe up with sand. Now it's tough because it's 10 foot, and how do you get the sand in there? So I had to find a way to do that. You can use a ladder to do that. I guess you could use an 8-foot ladder that would get you up high enough, and then you're able to do it. It's not so difficult. You fill the PVC pipe up with sand. Then you put the other cap on and tape it up. So now you have something that weighs about 15 pounds or, you know, 10 or 15 pounds or something. And then what you do is you grab it, your hands, you know, pretty close together, and you start shaking it like this. And you know those shaker exercises, that shaking things? Well, this is a super shaker thing. And the whole pipe flexes. And so you get this tremendous workout for your upper body and your arms and your shoulders and everything by doing these different exercises, by shaking this bar side this way and up and down. And the ends keep, you know, flex. And so it just gives you a tremendously great workout. And it's, you know, what it cost me, like $5 or something? All right, well, the PVC pipe, under $10. You know, tremendous piece of workout equipment right there. That is super good, super, super helpful. And it you can do it as easy as you want to. It's not like lifting heavy weights. It gives you a different sort of flexibility workout that you're being hit from different angles, and you have to react to it like this instead of you just, you know, forcing this weight up or something. This is like flexing, and you have to, like, so it gives you wonderful balance and flexing training like that. And this just happened today. It was amazing, the Holy Spirit, how it all happened for me. So, you know, I'm inventing exercise equipment for people, and you could do it. You know, there's no secrets here. I'm telling you what's going on. Jump rope, also very good. And that other stuff. There's another. You could probably. I'll have to look into this. But there's a. You could get like 6-inch PVC pipe. Fill that up with sand. Put caps on it, and make it like about 4 feet, 4 feet section or something. And then use that for all these, twisting exercises, something like that. I use various things for twisting. That this awkward, kind of awkward, and you have to like move it around your head and like this, and so the weight keeps shifting. And you could even leave some gap in there for the sand to move. If you get 6-inch PVC or 4-inch PVC pipe, it will like shift and move. So anything that's like, oh, I got it. Oh, it shifted and moved on me like that. Training your body and your mind to expect stuff to shift on you unexpectedly. I might even try. I'll probably even try that just to show you. Yeah, I can find a way to do that somehow. I will. Most likely. And see whether 4-inch, 6 inches like might be too hard to grab. You can grab it by the ends, which is fine. I'll find out. I'll find out. I'll try it out. I have some extra sand. I'll put together like a, was it 3-inch, 4-inch, 6-inch? We'll see. And the shifting sand is an interesting concept, isn't it? You could fill it up with water too. Okay, water's pretty doggone heavy, isn't it? So anything like throws your balance off, and other this static weight training, it's not that great. It's not that great. There's nothing wrong with it if that's just part of what you do. But I think you have to have something that keeps shifting on you. Like, whoa, that shifted. I thought I had it, and whoa, the water moved. Oh, that throws me off balance. So get used to being thrown off balance by what you're doing with your exercising. So it just becomes like second nature to just always somehow keep your balance. Of course, the Tai Chi does this, does it not? Puts you in these positions that you have to be used to being balanced here. Then you move to this one. It's all about keeping your balance. And this is, of course, an ancient practice that stay centered no matter what happens. So Tai Chi is also another good one. I've never done it, but I can see, the benefit and how they're able to stay very calm like this. So if you can do Tai Chi, I would say that's very good. And who knows? I might do that at some point. It comes from long practice and spiritual wisdom in terms of the world keeps throwing curveballs and knuckleballs at us by design to get us to forget about God. We've made this very nasty dream up. Designed to continually sabotage us. So we never ever look to realize that God is everywhere. We're always thinking that God is somewhere, which means there's also somewhere that God is not. And then we end up thinking the place where God is not is safety. And the idea that God is everywhere then threatens us horribly, thinking, oh my God, the only place way I can be safe is to jump into a total abyss. And this is what the world is coming to, especially the liberals. You have to say that. At least the conservatives have some religion, okay, where they think, no, I think I know God's somewhere. But you get rid of God, what's going to happen is you're going to have the terrible, terrible fear of the abyss if going that way. As I say, both sides are poisonous snakes, because the conservative is basically just giving you an excuse to be lazy. Says, yeah, don't look, we'll take care of God for you. You don't have to do that. Don't, just help us out, and we'll have a talk with God, and God will say, yeah, I'm somewhere, not everywhere, and we'll call it good and say, okay, great, thanks. So everything's fine. And we'll just keep hiding here in the planet Earth. Right? So, that's terrible too. A false sense of security. The conservatives offer a false sense of security. The liberals offer the fear of the abyss. So both are very poisonous snakes. I know both sides very, very clearly. So don't align with either one. There's some good posters on Facebook that are helping me out. They always seem to post something that's really very nicely non-dual. Yeah, there's some that are pretty far, you know. Seems like they have a lot generated some clarity in their lives. But here we're talking about the 360 pragmatism. I mean, it's not enough to just, you know, parrot what Nisargadatta Maharaj has to say. As the Holy Spirit told me, he says, you're fine with that. But physically, you have to understand, you don't want to get pulled into the yoga girl thing because they don't have any mental training at all. And they'll just lead you into the fear of the abyss. And their thing is just, I got to, you know, have kids and raise the next generation. And that's what's important. And keep everybody fixated on more bodies, you know, that as if that's the answer. And if you're not fit, you're going to look, start idolizing the yoga girls because they're very fit. It's not a joke. Like I said, at 6:30 in the morning, the gym is full of these yoga girls, and they're just hammering these workouts. And they're, as far as their core, I mean, they're just ridiculously fit. And you see them everywhere. Here are the ones that, you know, have the money and all this. They just walk around like Amazons. They are Amazons, actually. It's very intimidating. If you see someone that's just extraordinary fit, you know, you feel it like, wow, I'm not even close to that. It's very intimidating. And of course they know it. So they walk around in these real tight tights and bare midriffs and everything, and they like, look at me, I'm just like awesomely fit. Well, that's they've dedicated their lives to that. And they say, well, how awesomely fit are you mentally? You know, what? I'm awesomely fit. Oh, yoga thing? Yeah. I do the Ayurveda thing, you know. Yeah, you're really the chia seed thing, and this is, oh yeah, that's yeah. I just do some meditation. Yeah, it's just, oh, yeah, right. Yeah, I'm mentally fit. Sure. They don't have a clue. They bluff their way through that one. They bluff their way. Yeah, I know this guru. This one. Yeah. No, you know a Dharma king, and then we'll talk about, you know, how fit you are, because the Dharma king will say, hey. You gotta get you're not fit at all. You better start working at this. That's what they tell you. Holy Spirit says, you know, hey, you're weak at this. Do this, do this. And, you know, the Holy Spirit does cross training, spiritual cross training with you. Just when you think you got it, Holy Spirit says, yeah, but how about Padmasambhava? But you got that? And I'm like, well, he seems like a wild man. I don't know. Is it? So I know I don't have that. The Holy Spirit says, "Well, let's see. Let's take a look at that." So wow, okay. It's like, oh, okay. It's like, okay, wow. Love Padmasambhava for now. He's magnificent. But you have to be in real good shape to see that. Real good spiritual shape. So the Holy Spirit, you know, just when you think, okay, you got it, it's like the Laird Hamlin thing. No, okay, here's another practice. You need to try this. Whoa, that threw me off balance. Again, Laird Hamlin may be, you know, one of the world's greatest athletes ever. He understands the principle here of cross training and presenting, continuing to present yourself, being willing to present yourself with something that throws you off balance and say, okay, how can I handle this? Okay, the Holy Spirit is a spiritual cross trainer, and it keeps, you know, keeps throwing stuff your way. You think, oh my gosh, but we're in training, so what's wrong with that? If you just realize your life is nothing but you're in training, you're in like spiritual boot camp, then you don't get upset about it. You say, well, that's great. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. This is what I came here for. I didn't come here to take it easy, like the ego tells me to do, and just waste my life another, wasting that life again. No, I've done that too many times already. So yesterday I sang a lot. Today my voice was, but I still tried to do something, but I'm almost like hyperventilating. I'm got to But it's pretty cool. It's pretty cool because I couldn't really sing leads. So I'm just doing all this background, and first time I've ever really done this, and I'm starting to get the hang of it a little bit and realize, hey, I can do this. I can sing background. Wow. And no greater vocal band than the Beach Boys has ever existed, actually. And so you can really practice all these different roles. In listening to the songs, you can do the lead, you can do the high lead, you can do the chorus. You can be the one that doubles up on the lead and lower down. You can do the background, ooh, wow, various stuff. And you can do the bass part. There's just all this stuff going on. You can do any. You can just choose like what part you want to do, and then jump around from one to the other. It's amazing. There's so much going on there, actually. And just doing a 2-track tape recorder back then. That's just amazing. It's wizardry. I think we've gotten lazy with all, what happened was with all these multi-track, now you can have, a million channels. People just gotten lazy and robotic and stuff. Back then, they had to just nail it and have their parts down and be able to sing together and get that on one track. And then, they had to be really, it's something about they couldn't be lazy about it. So I'm having a blast doing that, singing, getting better at it, getting better at it, bit by bit. When you work out, you're tired, you're sore. The same thing with the voice. It's tired, it's sore, stretched out, can't hit the high parts today. I don't know, like five voices is just barely hardly talk. But there again, I read a quote by Krishnamurti. Someone posted on Facebook a quote, which is a great quote. And this is, I grew up with Krishnamurti, so I'm a big fan of Krishnamurti. And he says, he was talking to somebody and he said, "Are you happy?" And I said, "What do you mean?" And basically, it got around to that. What the problems we have is we keep thinking about the future. And what we're going to say, what we're going to do, and this puts grooves in our minds of expectations. And we're really basing this on the past of how people reacted in the past. And so we're thinking, okay, I need this, what I need to say, think that I do, and you plan. And Krishnamurti said, there's nothing worse than that for the mind. Well, of course, that's what we all do. And of course, I say, well, what else can we base it on except the past? I mean, don't people have habitual reactions? They certainly do. But that's not quite his point. Now, what he says is that when he goes to give a talk, he has no preconceived notions whatsoever what he's going to say. And of course, I don't either when I tape here. And he says that when you do it that way, you find this, there's a freshness and a vitality and a sharpness to it all, which is true, which is absolutely true. What he's saying is true. But it seems pretty difficult to do, right? Don't we usually? But I have found more and more and more and more that by simply not having any expectations of what I might say, I feel 360 degree, and people like that better because I'm more out there. I'm not in my mind. I'm there. I'm not in my mind, meaning following these thoughts that I've already, recorded in my mind about how I'm going to react or talk or do it. I'm saying, okay, whatever happens, I'm just here, and it seems to work. This is what Krishnamurti was telling us. And then I said, well, with music, that's also true. So when I hear a song, I don't know how I'm going to sing it. I try not to have any idea of how I'm going to sing it. And so what happens is, I feel I'm actually way more creative. If you think, okay, here's a song, this is how I sing it, that, it's stale. It's stale. Whereas if you don't have any preconceived notions of anything, you come in, it sounds fresh. It sounds vital. It sounds creative. This is where George Jones was a pretty amazing, I think he used alcohol to erase his memory and kind of just like put him in this mood, but he never sang the same song the same way twice. So there's like a lot of versions of some of his songs, like I'll Share My World With You. Some songs, there's like, five or six different recorded versions out there that he recorded. Every one of them is different. And it drove his producers crazy because every time he did a take, he'd do it differently. So he had an overall feel for the song, but somehow it would come out different every time because he was so just, somehow it was just, there was some freshness and acuity and sharpness there. It's very interesting. And you could hear it. I could tell the difference musically. I'm very sensitive musically. I may have been a lousy composer, but I'm certainly a musical expert. Nobody will argue that. And so I have the sensitivity. I can hear it. And the singers that are just singing it, this is the way I sing it. There's a deadness to it. Yeah, it's nice, but it's a nice deadness. But with someone else, it's like, it was just fresh approach. It feels like, wow, this is kind of alive. I like that. And I tend to sing a song differently. Every single time I sing a song, I do it differently. And I try not to really remember what I sang, how I sang it before. And I don't use drugs to do this at all. Musicians use drugs to try and get this edge, to knock out their patterns and stuff. But it has all sorts of side effects, very much unwanted side effects, very bad. But artists are quite desperate to get that edge that the audience likes, and they have a hard time, blocking out their thoughts, and they want to be spontaneous, and yet they end up being, robotically spontaneous, and that's not it either. We went through that, musically. We've been through it all over the last 50 years, and there were a lot of people in the 60s, in the 70s groups that, were like, let's be like really wild, spontaneous, and it became all contrived, all this contrived spontaneity, and I found it to be very, very boring, very boring. Music got very boring. Even the Beach Boys became boring because they were more into, studio wizardry and how, instead of just this more just more snappy kind of music that just, I don't know, the early stuff was way better. They ended up bogging down in, look how much stuff we can do in the studio. Whereas before, they could do very little. So it was all about how can we sing it to make it sound great? How can we make all the parts sound great right up front? Where then they started getting all these multi-track and capabilities in the studio. And they'd be, started, I can do this, and I can do this, and I can do this, and I this. And they forgot about the simplicity and make something that we can sing along with and harmonize this way and that way. It got lost. It got lost in the complexity of it all. And it was terrible, actually. Music was way better when it was simpler. The singers had to be great. You couldn't fake it, all this stuff that they fake now. They fake everything now. It sounds fake, doesn't it? It's all fake. The music you hear, you go in these stores, and it's interesting. I notice the music. I'm here. I notice it. It's easy for me to know what's going on musically. And I said, I've been in this store for an hour and a half, and every single song is a, girl group song, girl bands. It's all women singers, female singers, single songs. It's all the same stuff. And it's like shopping music. It's like make you feel, emotionally insecure, so you like buy stuff. It's the same garbage. It's amazing. I said, what is this? This music is just programmed, psychologically programmed for you to help you feel secure about yourself in shopping, 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 and saying, this is what I am, this is what I do. This is, I was like, wow. There's not a single male voice there at all. This is what we've come to. They found out that women do most of the purchasing decisions. So the more and more the music is going towards the female sound. It's just this ridiculous garbage, actually. It's just terrible. It sounds fake. It sounds phony. It sounds materialistic. It sounds juvenile. You know, it's just, there's nothing there. And that makes you feel insecure, makes you feel dead. And what do? You shop when you feel that way. You shop and you think, you know what? These drugs and these pharmaceuticals, I think I could probably benefit from some of that stuff. And they start buying into that. And of course, when they buy into it, they send their kids there too. So the pharmaceutical companies targeted women. These big corporations absolutely have targeted women. That's their number one target. That's why women are so messed up right now. Because they've been targeted. Because why? They train their children. They train the next generation. And who brings the kids to the doctor? The mom does. And who says, hey, you know, yeah, you should take this pill and this one too, and that'll help you in this one also. Mom does. It's mom that does that. So the pharmaceutical companies have targeted mom, okay? So if you're a woman, you have been targeted to an extreme extent. And you, part of repentance is to realize this, that you're the ones they've been after. And it's, guess what? It's not men's fault. It's not, men are not the pharmaceutical companies have tried to blame it all on men and said, no, they're the bad ones. Why? Because men might say, hey, you know what? I don't think these pills are good for the kid. And I don't think this is great, you know. And no, men don't know what they're talking about. They're crazy. Don't listen to them. Now, it's the pharmaceutical companies that are lying to you. And want your kids to be professional sickers, sickos. You want your kids to be professional sickos. And how many of your kids are professional sickos? A lot, right? A lot. An extreme amount now. An extreme amount. Didn't used to be that way at all. So, don't blame the men. Blame the pharmaceutical companies, and the big corporations, who program, have targeted you through the media and the entertainment industry and certain, you know, political parties and the media. They're extreme liars, okay? They are extreme liars. Don't trust anything the media says at all. Just don't even pay any attention to them. Like, I boycott the media entirely. You can never trust them. Entertainment industry, you cannot trust the entertainment industry at all. They're totally corrupt, bought and paid for. They work for these corporations. Music industry is so corrupt. Don't pay attention to that, the modern entertainment at all. I go back to the, you know, earlier times. Wasn't nearly as bad back then. If you need your entertainment, I make my own entertainment. This is very helpful. My singing is my own entertainment, and I can sing really well to these songs. And to me, it's fabulous entertainment. I have a blast doing it. I have an absolute blast because I make the music sound better. Better. That's right. Because you got the basic backing tracks of these songs. I listen to Beach Boys and George Jones. That's it. And great backing tracks for you to sing to. And so I put in different chorus, I put in, you know, different harmonies, different inflections, all sorts of stuff that makes it sound bigger and better. And that's a lot of fun, believe me. A lot of fun. I'm just laughing and clapping. I'm saying, my gosh, here comes this song. Okay, how am I gonna do this to him? I don't know. But I'm gonna be creative, there's no question about it, however I feel, and you end up singing it in a different way that you say, I never heard that. I never heard it sound like that before. Wow, that was really cool. So I don't need the entertainment industry at all. Don't need the pharmaceutical industry. I don't take any medicine whatsoever, not even an aspirin. I don't need them at all. And I don't need the entertainment industry at all. And I don't need the news industry at all. The only news worth hearing is the hearing about the Dharma Kings, and they give me that news firsthand. So I've got my news, I've got my entertainment, and I've got my health. So I'm not controlled by these interests that are controlling the world, trying to turn you into a zombie. And again, especially the women, have been targeted to an extreme extent. And I've tried my whole life to warn them about this. And they just, they have a vulnerability, which is their children. And the doctors and stuff, the pharmaceutical companies control the doctors, and the doctors have medical care. They said, well, don't you want your children to be healthy? Don't you want them to have a happy life? And then this guilt complex that women get, you know, it's just like, it's devastating. They can't seem to stand up to it. Some do, they get real feisty. But then they become fixated. They're still brittle about it. They're very angry because they are nervous about their children. For sure, this is a problem that women have. A really big, bad problem they have, and it's exploited. These rascals, these very mischievous aspects of our ego, exploit this. I don't have any natural children at all, so. I don't have any thoughts about children whatsoever, so I can't be exploited that way at all. They cannot touch me that way. You know, how do you raise children? I don't worry about that. So it's very, very helpful. So I say for women, it's best to be a nun, actually. Be a renunciate. So they can't get their claws into you that way, but you still have feelings, you know, for other children, and okay, I want to help them and stuff. It's very difficult. And it's very gutsy to, and of course the laws have been changed where women who try to raise their children right now, that now they're called criminals. They've criminalized it. So women have been under this virtually impossible gun in the world. And so they have struggled, to say the least. And they're floundering, to say the least. And they're very brittle and upset because they're like, they've been boxed in and trapped. And then they think, well, a convenient whipping boy kicked the dog, which is the man, kicked the dog, right? They're so frustrated. Who can they kick? Well, they can always kick the man, can't they? And so they're kicking the man too much. And you got to realize that. That's got to stop. It's got to stop. We're not here to be punching bags for frustration. Okay, we have our own spiritual salvation that we have to attend to. We can't just be punching bags. So, you know, it's a tough situation all around. Very tough. So women have to repent. They have to repent and realize they've been targeted and just cool it. They've been targeted to an abominable extent by very, very vicious, unconscionable operatives that, you just call them, in the past they call them the devil. They've been targeted by the devil, you know, absolutely. So, I have ultimate compassion for him, but I'm not going to let that pull me down, right? No. I chose where I am now, and consciously chose to be in a situation where I can't be pulled down so easily, whereas other people, they chose to put themselves in a vulnerable position thinking that they were smart enough to handle. Well, guess what? They're not. You're never smart enough to handle, in this world, a very vulnerable position. If you put yourself in a it's going to be exploited. The ego will exploit it. So women are always thinking they could do better for their children. They failed their children. I got to try. I don't want to fail my kids. But the best way to do it is to teach your kids about the Holy Spirit and say, look, I follow the Holy Spirit and I trust in the Holy Spirit. And this is how you can live too. This is the right way to raise your kids, is trust in the Holy Spirit, trust in the grace of God, trust in non-dual teaching, you know, trust that nothing can happen to us except it's our own choice, that includes children, and raise your children the godly way. This is the right way, and this is what's under such severe attack right now, especially from the liberals, because conservative people tend to want to raise their children in godly ways, try to, at least their version of godliness, which is distorted. But, you know, that any inclination of raising your children in godly ways, the pharmaceutical companies hate that, because guess what? It could go towards Christian Science, couldn't it, at some point? They say, hey, wait a minute, I can use my mind to heal this. Wow, I didn't know I had that power. Oh, now I found that I did. Wow, this is great. Do you think the stockholders of pharmaceutical companies want you to know that you can heal yourself with your mind? No. Not even remotely do they want you thinking in that direction. So they pay the entertainers. The only place entertainers can play now is in casinos, basically. These older entertainers, casinos. Come in, lady luck, you know. So they're luring you in to this trap through entertainment. So you'll start getting hooked on the idea of luck. That luck is your God. Luck and a dog. What more do you need, you know, right? Lady luck and a dog is the modern New World Order. That's the religion. Lady luck and a dog. God, what's that? They don't know what you're talking about. Of course they don't. Because all they can think of is their greed. Greed, you know, is running the world right now. It's a severe sin. All they can think about is, I need more things so I don't fall into that terrible abyss. Well, stop trying to want to separate from God and you realize there is no abyss. It's called repentance from arrogance. Duh. You know? How could we be ignorant of that? I mean, to be ignorant of that is to be pathologically ignorant. Willfully pathologically ignorant. And so why should we hitch our destiny, those who are willfully pathologically ignorant? No basis for that on reason or reality whatsoever. Yeah, so they're going to go into this total paranoia. I got to say, the liberals are getting very paranoid, extremely paranoid. And the conservatives, you know, they're no bargain either, all right? Don't get in bed with them either. But the paranoia that's coming up is extreme paranoia. Some of the stuff I hear is just like, wow. Nothing's too paranoid, you know. Oh, the sky will fall, you know. We'll, what they mean is, we may not be able to hide it from God, you know. You're driving us into an abyss. Which is, you know, it's complete insanity on their part. So basically the inmates are trying to run the asylum. Both. I mean, the conservatives think they have it figured out. They think they have Jesus figured out. They don't. They got it all wrong, actually. They're getting it more wrong and more wrong all the time, right? This is true. Christianity's going down the tubes also. The way that Christianity is being practiced now, they got it very much mistaken. And that's the conservative. The conservatives have their religion very messed up. They have it, the ego's got it. You know, the way the ego wants it. And so the ego says, yeah, this is it. And they go, oh, okay. As long as the labels are there, Jesus and God and this, and okay, that's fine. So they got religion wrong. And the liberals, they want to get rid of it altogether. Because, you know, a wrong religion is better than none at all, actually. Because at least you realize that there's something I need to get. You know, and there is a God, and there is something I need to get, and there is the grace of God. So there's always the possibility you might say, hey, wait a minute, okay, well, that's it, okay. So the ego wants to get rid of that altogether. Lady luck and a dog is what the ego wants you to have. Hey, here's lady luck on my arm, and I got a dog on a leash. My God, I'm living the good life. Now, tomorrow, you know, like, wow. I know the Holy Spirit is going to want me to work out. I'm not going to hold any preconceived ideas one way or the other, but, you know, it wouldn't surprise me I said, oh, man, okay, it's go time. I gotta get in better shape. I ordered something. It's coming. Should be here in less than a week. Some sort of balance thing. It's an ex piece of exercise equipment that helps you with your balance and strengthen your core, because it is designed to keep throwing you off balance as you try to do exercises on it. It's some sort of inflatable dome or something, of rubberized dome that it's not stable. So whatever you do on it's not quite stable. And so you try to balance on one foot, one leg, and balance doing everything, and you keep, whoa, moving this way, moving this way. That's super, super great exercise. Super good. And of course, I was thinking, I don't need to do that. That's too difficult. But no, in the long run, it's really good, because we won't have any stable ground to stand on very soon in this world. We won't have any stable ground to stand on. So I'll see how this works out. And if it works out great, I'll recommend it to you. I really recommend everybody that they start doing some sort of balancing stuff that helps the stabilizer muscles, to start strengthening those, because we won't have any stable ground to stand on very soon. So we'll see how this works out and what kind of recommendations. That PVC thing is very good. I tried it today. Oh my gosh. You can do it gently, or if you do it faster and move your hands closer, it gets stronger. If you move your hands farther apart, then it can be gentle, and the more you closer you move them, the stronger the flex is and the more intense the workout is. So you can vary it perfectly. I mean, it's like awesome piece of workout equipment for like $10. The caps and the bag of sand are $5, and the piece of PVC, I didn't price it out. But I don't know, it's probably like around $5 or something. So you're in the ballpark like $10 to make this insanely great workout, X piece of workout equipment. Insanely great. $10. And pretty much any of us can do that. And Holy Spirit will help you out if you can't. Fill it with dirt if you have to. Yeah, right? And maybe you'll find a piece of PVC somewhere and just buy a couple caps for like a dollar. You can make it real cheap. Don't get the thin walled. Don't even go the SR35. Get a Schedule 40. Get Schedule 40. Okay? That's a thicker walled PVC. Make sure the caps fit those too, but you'll be taping them on anyway. They make two other types of drainage pipe, which are much thinner walled, and those will crack on you. You need the thicker walled stuff for the flexing that you're doing, so it doesn't snap on you. And you could even go to, electrical conduit pipe, the gray stuff, which is even stronger, but I don't think you need that. I think just the white Schedule 40 would work great for you. And remember, if you're in bad shape, and when this hits the fan and the instability, there's no stable ground to stand on, you're gonna look for somebody. Guess who's there? Mama Yoga Girl's gonna be there for you. And she goes, look at the stability. I have flexibility, physical, wow. And you're gonna start idolizing the Yoga Girls. And remember, they don't have any mental training. They're not in touch with the Dharma Kings. They don't have the big picture at all. They're very good bluffers, though. They say, "Yeah, but look at how lush my eyelashes are, and look how sleek I am, and look at my hair, look at my complexion, look at my superficial, how together I am," and you'll start falling for it. You will start falling for that. We're all vulnerable to that, but they don't have the they're not grounded in the true non-dual perspective, which. Dharma contact with Dharma Kings, you get contact with the true non-dual perspective, and you have to then start experiencing that. Not the non-dual path is not something you learn; it's something you have to experience. And this is what the Yoga Girls don't get. They keep thinking they can learn it, and you hear these teachers, these non-dual teachers. I call them that because they do at least talk about it and try to bring up bring it up, how to meditate. So, but a lot of the people they're talking to, they go to universities and these places, and all these academic yoga girls come and see them and ask questions. Okay, and this, they're really earnest, but they're trying to learn it, like you learn yoga, like it works. You can't learn the non-dual path. You have to experience it. You have to accept it, and you have to know that this is true, and this rings the bell of knowingness. And then your whole psyche is affected by this. Every time you ring that bell of knowingness, it reverberates throughout your entire psyche, and then you have to then just full stop on the wow and just experience it. It's an experience. The real non-dual path is an experience. You're experiencing this. It's very intense. You have to be very dedicated and disciplined to do it right, because you are going through this experience time and time and time and time again. It's not academic. And all these modern people who have been gone through the university, and they've managed to succeed by doing what they think the teacher wants them to do. They get this non-dual teacher there, and they say, okay, how can I get an A from this teacher? Like, they need to get a grade, an A grade. But they're not willing to really experience it. And you can never get it that way, the way they're going about it. Nothing. You're just flat. You got the verbiage. That's all superficial. It's like you're going to the spiritual beauty parlor is all that's happening. And, there are those who can go to the spiritual beauty parlor and come out, and they got all this makeup and all dolled up. They say, wow, it's like, open your eye, wow. That's the trouble that we all face. Those who go to the spiritual beauty parlor, they get all dolled up, and we think they're it. They're not it. Contact with the Dharma kings is what you're looking for. Because this really, really, really puts you into experiencing. And you realize, hey, you can't avoid it. This is where it's really at. You talk about flipping your script. You talk about getting your bell rung. And then you realize, wow, I never know when I'm going to get my bell rung. I have to really get serious about this and experience it every day. Every day experience it. Experience the path. Don't think it. Don't analyze it. Don't plan for it. Don't think about it. Don't emotionalize it. Don't do any of that. Just experience it. Full stop, the wow, experience the wow of it. It's always a wow to it. When you're on the non-dual path, you're just feeling this wow, very intense wow of, this is shockingly clear to me. Oh my gosh, it's I don't even need my thinking to be clear about this. It's just completely clear. I'm experiencing. It's just completely clear. I know it's completely clear. I don't even need to think about it. It's so clear. This is very shocking. But what do I? All this thinking and thoughts. I go. Well, what do I? I don't need any of that. No, that's just all imagined limitations on what we are. As Sargada Maharaj said, we don't lose our identity. We just lose our limitations that imagined. We've placed upon it. That's all we lose, is the limitations that we've imagined. Are part of our, has happened to our identity, where in fact it hasn't happened to our identity. So we don't lose our identity, just these imagined limitations, that's it. But when we see that, we think, oh my gosh, I'm going to lose a large part of my identity, because we keep thinking these limitations are part of our identity. They're not. They're not at all. So the yoga girls, they're stirring up trouble. They really are. They just basically say, hey, look, we have to focus on the physical so much. You got to cut us some slack, because we just don't have the time to focus on the mental. No, what kind of slack can we cut? It's not possible to cut any slack. You have to say to them, you have to cut us some slack. and realize that we know what we're talking about. And you may not be, you know, the expert you think you are. That's cutting us some slack, you know? We're cutting you some slack and saying, yeah, we understand that you might be behind, you've been targeted so severely that you're floundering, okay? So we acknowledge that and we're here to help. That's cutting you some slack. Now cut us some slack by realizing that you aren't the expert you think you are, and listen to the ones that have actually done the work and actually experienced the non-dual path instead of just gone to a teacher and tried to figure out, how do I get an A in this class? I'm not figuring out how to get an A. Yeah, I'm figuring out how not to drown. You know, the experiencing is so strong. It's like, how do I swim? Or you could flip it and say, how do I drown consciously in this truth, in the non-abyss? You could look at it either way. Either way is fine. So don't, you know, no divide and conquer here. You know, you can look at it either way. You could say, how do I get into this formless grave, and you know, that's where I need to be. Or, you know, you could say it different, in a different way too. How do I keep from the grave of you know, falling asleep to what I am? So however you want to emphasize it, it's fine, as long as you're experiencing it. And the academics, since they're not experiencing it, they keep trying to nitpick. Well, wait a minute, is it this or this? How do I get an A in this class? By experiencing it, that's how you get an A. And they say, no, I've got to work on this. You know, I can't do that. You don't expect that of me. My children, blah, blah, blah. Again, best thing anyone can do for their children is experience the non-dual path. And then the children say, oh, that's okay to do that culturally. Oh, okay, then I'll do that too. Right? It's amazing how much children look at role models and adults and see what they're doing and say, okay, I look back on my life, I realize that that's how you are when you're young. You copy what people do, and you see what other people do, and the adults say, okay, that's okay for me to do that then. We don't like to admit that, but it's true. So children really do emulate the elders. They really do. So let them emulate you experiencing the non-dual path. What are you doing, Mom? I'm in the wow of experiencing this non-dual shock of clarity. Clarity is so easy. It's just so easy. It's so simple. Like, I could do it all the time. It's so simple and easy. Wow. And the kid will say, oh, wow, okay. So that's okay. Mom's doing that, so it must be okay for me to do it. And then they rest in the simplicity of clarity themselves. You see how it works that way? And women, you can then end up trying to say, well, it's not fair. A guy's born a woman. But no, nobody, everybody chooses what they're born as. And the answer is, well, two different reasons. You might want it, you know, to shape children's lives in a large part, because you have a super powerful role. So it could be on an ego trip. You have such a powerful role. I don't want to be a parent. I mean, you know, who am I to shape a child's life, have that much power over somebody? I don't even like the idea of having that much power over someone at all. Let the Holy Spirit have that power. So, you know, it could be a power trip, ego trip they're on. If you want to be a woman, have children, it could be a very strong ego trip. Or you might say, I would be very helpful and help shape them in the right way. Well, of course, that would be in the way of experiencing non-dual truth, listening to the Holy Spirit, and that would be the right way. But either way, you know, it's a sort of a kingmaker role, and that's a very tricky thing to do. So you have to be even more dedicated to be humble and not fall into that trap. It's just all you can do is do the best on yourself you can do. It's up to the kids to decide who they're going to follow. It's their own karma that's at play. You're not king and kingmaker. You're not kingmaker at all. We all follow our own mental patterns, habits, karma that we have in. So you just have to set the best example you can for yourself. And they say, oh, okay, mom's really working on herself here and really doing this. And says, ah, that's kind of cool. And it'll sink in. It'll sink in their lives. But somehow women think they're responsible for, other people's lives. No, they're not. They don't have that power. Don't have that power. Nobody has that power. We all have complete power over our own experiencing. So, at this stage of the world, women have to take a back seat because they've been so lusting after driving the bus for the last 100 years, actually. And this put them in a very vulnerable position. Enabled them to be targeted, very severely targeted. The wise women realize this and they say, whoa, 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 whoa. I feel that I don't want to be too much, too ambitious because I know I can be easily targeted and this is a problem. That's correct. That is correct. Because they're after your children. Okay? They're after your children. So they're targeting you, mom. You got to be humble. As mothers have to be humble. They cannot get too high and mighty. It's a very delicate situation. So right now the women have to take a back seat. The only safe place for women right now is taking a back seat, being humble about it and realizing, wow, I was severely targeted and I'm going to have to recover from this. And you can. You have to recover from it. But by insisting on driving the bus, you're not going to recover from it at all. You're just going to make it even worse, way worse. Because then you're going to suppress all the men that have done a lot of tough mental work, a lot of very difficult work. You're not going to listen to them at all. This is what the pharmaceutical companies want. They don't want you to listen at all. Not at all. They say, no, you're supposed to drive the bus. Well, of course they want you to drive the bus. Because you're going to set examples for your kids that they want to set. And you need to say, whoa, wait a minute, Let the first set the example to my kids of I'm listening to someone who knows what they're talking about. It's a very important example that women can set, mothers can set for their kids, is I'm paying attention to somebody who knows what they're talking about. The kids see that and say, wow, I can pay attention to experts too. That's a really good idea. That's what my mom does. And this will be very, very beneficial for your kids. Instead of thinking, hey, my mom knows best about everything. She didn't have to pay attention to any expert. She's the total expert in everything. That's what you don't want. That's what you don't want. Because women are not experts in everything by any means. Not by a long shot. So this is really very crucial and it's honest, straight talk. And women have to be very wise right now. And this high and mighty trip that they're on is designed to trip them up. It's designed to trip them up. They're way overconfident. The pharmaceutical companies want them overconfident. That's what they want. Say, guess what? You already know everything. Don't listen to these men. They're stupid. Don't you? Oh, yeah, okay. Because then that cuts, sets an example to the children. Hey, children, don't listen to the elders, the wise elders. Don't listen to them. And then there's a vacuum. What comes into the vacuum? You know what comes into that vacuum. People, those who want greedy, want the greedy ones who want your kids to do life, be a lifetime of sickness. Milk them for everything they've got. Work, 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 sick, 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 sick. Live a horrible life. And then pass that horrible life on to their kids. Greed knows no boundaries. No, greed knows no constraints. It's a sickness. It's a vile, terrible sickness. And the world's in the clutches of this greed and fear. Greed and fear, greed and fear. Fear of the abyss, desire to separate from God, which means automatically it makes you think that you're in danger of jumping into an abyss. Automatically. Because since God's everywhere, how can we escape God? There must be some terrible abyss somewhere. There's some total abyss that I can jump into. How else can you keep entertaining the idea of separating from God unless you have to believe in some abyss. And that dominates your psyche and you have to defend against it. And you think sickness is a great defense against it, actually. You think sickness is a great defense against it. It gets better here. Don't worry. It gets better. So you have to do the straight talk. I know that most women, you know, just hate it, might hate it. I don't know. I know there must be some that don't hate it. That's why I'm saying it. Otherwise, what's the purpose of even saying it at all? Because women used to be wise. They used to be quite wise, actually. Way wiser than now. Feminism hasn't made women wiser. It's made them much, much stupider. Way stupider. Women, you say, whoa, wait a minute. No, not so fast here. You know, we're not as great as you're trying to tell us. We got issues. We understand that. You know, I got a severe continuity problem here. Okay, so, and Jesus is better at handling this and the Holy Spirit than the pharmaceutical companies. And, you know, hey, no thanks, devil. You know, they used to be that way to some extent. You know, they're not perfectly, of course, but they said, well, not so fast. Here, wait a minute. Men are pretty expert in some stuff. I'm not going to just, you know, throw them off, push them off a cliff. You know, that's stupid. That's a bad idea. So most women rejected feminism at first. The wisdom said, no, this is a trick. This is a trap. It's a trick. And it turns out it was a trick and a trap. They're absolutely right about it. But the relentless efforts to market it, you know, is eventuated in the situation where women are doubting themselves. I'm talking to elder women, they start to doubt themselves, like, I'm not really sure, you know, it's like, So when you're in this, I'm not sure, that's not a good place to be in. And you better turn to the experts who are sure and start, and to work out of what has happened. It's going to take some work. Because they're going to be very angry at the farm, you know, at those, the devil, you know, of materialism, and very angry about that. When they see, you know, just how unconscionably they were targeted, and they have to realize it was their own fear, karmic fear, that ended up targeting them, and their vulnerability comes from continuity fear entirely. And so you have to forgive yourself. As soon as you repent, you forgive yourself. Because you realize you had a terrible problem that you didn't realize. Okay, so this is the key for women and for everyone. Is you can get over this, your anger, is by repenting and saying, I had a terrible problem, a continuity fear problem. I didn't realize how severe it was. That's the whole key to it. It was more severe than I thought. It's way more severe than we realize. And you have to just accept that it's so severe that I can't get cute about it. Okay, can't get tricky or cute about it. I just got to get down to business and just start working on it. And I can't say how long it's going to take, but I'll get there eventually. And that's it. That's it. And I don't need to talk about it anymore. I just got to work at it. That's it. You got to get to that point. He said, I'm not going to be played for a fool again. I'd be determined. But don't let anger, when anger creeps in, it blocks you, completely blocks you. You say, my vulnerability was the problem. Okay? And so if I'm no longer vulnerable, that solves the problem. Plain and simple, right? So I don't care who's tempting me. If I'm not vulnerable, it doesn't matter, does it? So don't worry about blaming anyone. It's your own continuity fear is to blame. For everyone, that's the case. It's the same for all of us. So you're on the same path as everyone. Is our own continuity fears to blame. Work on evaporating that continuity fear. And that'll take some time, for sure. Don't worry, it'll keep you very busy. You won't get bored. I promise you that. You will not get bored. It'll keep you very, very, very busy. And you just look back at the previous stuff and say, I was just stupid because I didn't realize how severe my problem was. That's all. If you just admit that your problem was more severe than you thought, way more severe, you'll forgive yourself. Plain and simple. And that's it. You're forgiven. You've forgiven yourself. And from there, you just have to work on evaporating the continuity fear. But you won't be all emotionalized about it. You won't. It knocks the emotions out of it. But you have to knock the emotions out. You can't go about it in an emotional way. Emotions are out. I don't get upset at anybody. I admonish people about the situation, but I don't get upset. I don't get emotionally upset or angry. Very rarely, actually, or hardly never. Because I know it's my own vulnerabilities the problem. So just have to work on that. Nothing can stop me. Nothing can stop me. It's all in my hands. It's all up to me. And I can just work my way out of it by evaporating this continuity fear. There's no abyss, you know. There's no abyss. Any fear of God, immediately the notion of an abyss arises for us. And then we say, how can I find a compromise where I can get rid of this fear of God and not jump into the abyss? And then we believe that this world and bodies and such is that. And yet, the fear, the threat still remains because God's still everywhere. And so it never works for us. We always feel insecure. And so deep within us, there's always this fear of the abyss, and that we may have to jump into it, and that other people are pushing us and threatening us to push us into that. And so we feel insecure towards others. We feel threatened by them and all of this. And we either overcompensate by being overly affectionate to others, or we go into a shell and become antisocial. Both of those are reactions to the fear of the abyss. You know, we've been through both things, right? The hermit sort of thing, and then the others are just, let's go around hugging everybody. You're like, no. Neither one of those. Neither one of those. I find I'm now in this sort of this wonderful groove of just, you know, I just lightly pat someone on the back or something, and they'll do the same to me. They go by and they sort of touch me on the shoulder like that, you know? It's just like that. This is where it's at. So we're not rejecting bodies and we're not clinging to bodies. Neither one. Neither one. You can be socially adept without saying, hey, give me a hug, give me a hug, give me a hug, give me a hug. I need affection, I need affection. And then that snowballs into sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and this all this body, you know, if it feels good, do it, and just this whole obsession with the body and all this stuff. That's a terrible trap. So there is this way. I didn't know. I never knew there was this way. We're all in this difficulty, right? And I find guys are starting to figure it out a little bit. They're saying, "Hey, wait a minute. You know, we don't have to be this way or that way. We don't have to all be paranoid about each other. We don't have to all be gay either. You know, neither one is necessary, actually. Right? You don't have to punch somebody in the shoulder. Hey, how you doing? You know, punch him and stuff like that. We used to do that or something. Just a light, hey man. You know, how's it going? Like that, or just a thumbs up. You know, hey, you know, just bump the hands. How's it going, man? Nice to see you. And it's just really, you know, it's just a struggle. Okay, we don't have to go either way. Maybe there's not an abyss. Maybe there's not an abyss. Maybe there's not an abyss. Huh? Isn't that possible too? It's like, hey. And they were starting to maybe I've seen it. They're starting to wake up. Men are starting to wake up, and realize that this thing, women are messed up. They know it. Every man I talk to knows that women are very messed up. Every single one. It's no secret at all. But again, we cut slack because of the issue of women raising children. It makes them way more vulnerable. They've been targeted. Okay, women can repent. They can realize, wow. I didn't realize my continuity fear was so severe. I thought I had it all together, but it made me vulnerable, and I was targeted. I knew I had to be more careful. Women have to be more careful than men because they're targeted, because they pass it on to the children. So they have to be more diligent and more careful. This is a fact. This is a fact. But then, of course, men have to put up with the women that aren't that diligent, and so it gets on their shoulders. So, you know, it's tough for everybody here. It's very tough for everyone. But every man knows that the women in their life, they're messed up. Every single man knows that. So it's not a secret. So just repent. Just say, yeah, I got turned around and upside down and messed up because I didn't realize how severe my continuity problem was. I didn't realize that it's extraordinarily severe. Okay, it's extraordinarily severe. Don't think that anybody is free from it here in terms of you or me or anyone else, okay? Unless you're an avatar or something, bodhisattva. Okay, it's extraordinarily severe. And the fear of the abyss makes fools of us all. So, just repent and forgive yourself. And as soon as you do that, you'll realize, hey, maybe men makes you like, oh, they're not as stupid as I thought they are. They're not as terrible as I thought they are. Wow. Maybe we can back away from the from this wretched future that we're going into, right? Maybe we can back away from that. Because I can actually start practicing now. I've forgiven myself. I'm not all trapped in my emotions anymore and bluffing. I don't need that. Well, what do I need to bluff for? I've already admitted I had this extremely severe problem. And so I don't need to bluff. I can start actually practice experiencing the path now instead of faking that I'm experiencing it. And the men will really see that and say, oh, wow, that's great. I can really get with it too now, also. So everything will turn around in a positive way in this way. But we cannot keep going the way that we've been going. This is a disastrous way. Repent. The answer is repentance. Forgive yourself. As Jesus said in the Course of Miracles, forgive yourself. The problems, the continuity fear problem is drastic and extreme, beyond, it's amazingly severe. And no amount of bluffing or cleverness or cuteness has any effect on it whatsoever. Don't kid yourself. Only dedicated evaporating of it through right spiritual practice, through experiencing the intrinsic clarity that's always present, that we're capable of, how simple and easy, it's right there right now. Glimpsing this, and this really shocks your psyche and your continuity fear, and it's just whoa. And your facade crumbles, and you think, oh, that's a bad example for my kids. No, it's not. It's a great example for your kids. It's the best example possible. Because guess what? They have a severe continuity fear too. And don't think that you as mother can somehow raise them so they don't. They do. They bring it in karmically. There's no way you could get around that. That's why mothers are scratching their heads like, my kid, what happened? I was a bad mother. No, you weren't. They came in with all that karma. Duh, Transmigration, they've been transmigrating for a long, 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 long time through many, many, many realms. We all have. So they do have severe continuity fear, just like you do, just like we all do. And so showing that you can evaporate it, that you've repented, forgiven yourself, and they're going to say, wow, I like that. That's the kind of mother I really like. If you don't do that, guess what? One day you'll find out your kids hate you. Because you thought you'd be the perfect mother and say, no, I'm raising perfect children. They don't have any problems. And they become adults and they have no clue to how to handle their continuity fear. And so they just live a life of just bluffing and they end up drug addicts and duh, wonder why. That's a real failure as a mother. Okay, so to be a success as a mother, you've got to forgive yourself and repent and realize you have a severe continuity problem. And guess what? Your children do too. They're born with it. It's called original sin. Everyone's born with severe continuity fear. They absolutely are. Else they wouldn't even be here, other than that the avatars have come into the world to help us. They wouldn't even be here. They wouldn't transmigrate into this realm and identify with the body at all. So they have a severe continuity fear. They're born with it. And all they can do is evaporate. You can't educate it out of anybody. They have to experience. You have to experience it out of you. You can't educate it out of anyone. You cannot. Education's a farce. It's bluffing. It's a bluff. Education is a bluff. It's a scam. You've got to experience it out of you. You've got to evaporate it out of you, this fear. You got to experience the clarity, the simple clarity, the ever-present clarity, the simplicity that they don't even need to think or do anything. Experience that over and over and over and over and over. Allow it, the glimpses to come. Not have a, don't experience the concept of it. That's the yoga girl, false path. Experience it literally. Actually, for a moment, have a holy instant, as Jesus puts it, and experience it. And that rocks your world. What rocks the world of your expectations? This is what Jesus is teaching us. You have to experience it, the holy instant. Just an instant, like that. Just like that. That's all you need. That rocks your world. You've experienced it now. Are you experienced? And it's not easier to bluff your way through life. That's hell. It's easier to experience this, the path. That's easier. Because it works. And you get better and better. When you bluff your way through life, your life gets worse and worse and worse. And eventually you just decide you're going to got to save face some way and die. You know, you feel trapped. Very trapped. Very trapped. And so many don't forgive themselves, therefore they bluff their way through life and they start getting more and more panic attacks. It's hell for them. It's hell. They need more drugs. They become just totally saturated with pharmaceuticals. Then they end up in some assisted living place, hooked up on tubes and drugs, and you know, that's it. That's it. That's just the price you pay for not repenting. It's too severe of a price, folks. Just go to the assisted living places like I have and experience it. Not a pretty picture. Okay, that's it. It just stopped on me. Okay, that's fine. Want to stop? You want to stop. Duration. 0000000. What do you mean 0000?